Have you knocked yourself out today? Have you been knocked out today, spiritually knocked out? Something so great just knocked you out. This is what we aim for every day. We practice full stop in the wow every day. This is a focus on practice continuously during the day. Be aware of your wow reactions. Fortunately, I was able to all day Sunday, I was able to work on some tremendous, beautiful graphics, putting together something for you that maybe you'll enjoy a lot. Saturday, I was so sick, I thought, I feel like I'm dying. I was just horrible. But I said, look, don't worry, it's psychosomatic. I'll bounce back. I bounced back Sunday, and today, Monday, I feel great. It was just nerves. I know that. So when we speak the truth in this world, there's a backlash, and you have to pay the price. But it may seem harsh, but it's not nearly as harsh as continuing with the path of making excuses for failure, which is all that this world really is. Bodies, this world, is nothing but excuses. We're just making excuses, and we will to fail. We're failing to reach what we are. We are what we are. We don't reach what we are. We are what we are. And so when we're trying to reach what we are, we feel like failure. And then what we do, in our arrogance, we're trying to say, no, I can reach it. We make excuses why we can't reach it. We say, oh, I'm sick. I'm dying. I had this tragedy. I really feel lousy. I'm tired. I'm really distracted. I'm confused. And we suffer. It's called suffering. Suffering is just an excuse. That's all that it is. Suffering is merely an excuse that we're using. So if we don't drop the excuses, we will continue with the excuses. Very simple, right? Now, it's amazing what we do, how foolish we are, which we double down on uncertainty. We say, no, life is uncertain. Reality is uncertain. We're trying to destabilize reality. So we say, reality is very uncertain. Life's very uncertain. And then we say, oh, but we're suffering. We're suffering. We're so terrible. And then we say, okay, I want to be certain that it's uncertain. That's the problem. Say, I'm not really certain that life is uncertain. So let's be sure. Let's be certain that life is uncertain. Uncertain. Life is uncertain. And then we'll be happy. Well, if you are certain that life is uncertain, then your life is, you're going to experience uncertainty. Right? Yet somehow we magically get confused and think, no, if I'm certain that life is uncertain, then I'll be certain. No. That's called, insanity. The opposite of sanity. It's the opposite of sanity. So the ego employs the opposite of sanity for us. So welcome to the video, everyone. And showing up here at the most opportune time, showing the commitment that is necessary. Now, the Golden State Warriors are trying to win the championship. It's the fourth quarter. Where am I? Am I watching the game? No, I'm out here taping. I say, to heck with that. I don't need to waste my time. Okay. Those who want to waste their time will have to do it without me. I'm no good at wasting time. Sorry, folks. So we are here getting to the root of it. And we are at the root of it. We're already there. We're already there, actually. We're already there. And it's just when we finally drop our efforts to get there, then this is realization. This is realization. Call it whatever you want. There's no label that really, any label can be confounded by the ego. You know, but we don't worry about that. Call it realization, call it whatever you want. We realize I'm already this. I'm already what I've been searching for. But only when we stop our efforts does it truly dawn upon us. But we're frightened. They say, well, if I stop my efforts, like that, I'll be certain. I don't want to be certain. I'm certain. I'm not used to being certain. What's that? Scary, scary. But when we stop our efforts to find what we are, relax your mind, release your thoughts, and let them go, as Jesus says. That's all we have to do. So, welcome to all the great bodhisattvas, wonderful, those of conscience and honesty who don't want to waste their time. Welcome to the video where we just provide a 360-degree kind of immersion in the wow, just the wow, just wow it. It's very important in your practicing, as you're working, get to the wow, get to a point where you feel this feeling in you that's just like, oh, wow. You know, like the feeling on a roller coaster. You suddenly go poof, down the hill, right? Like, and your stomach just, oh wow, this feeling like, oh wow, it's just, it's, you know, it's kind of like that. That's why we like the roller coasters. It's good to just feel like, oh, I'm sort of like just softly falling into something beautiful, and I'm floating, or I'm floating. Oh wow, I'm floating. And how do you get to this wow? Many, many ways, infinite ways. You have to do it right in the turmoil of your life. You have to find a way, and whatever it is, and just keep working at it. It's for me. Sometimes it's just enough to just use the name of a Dharma king. Just that name, that's enough. Wow. Now, with Jesus, they have tried to do something very tricky, the ego has, and that is to either put him in this category of so awesome that we're scared, like, ah, too awesome, or he's just a friendly rabbi, you know, social activist rabbi, leading vigils for victims or something like that, and then we just, it's too commonplace for us. So neither one of those brings a wow, actually. And they've really, really tried to knock out what Jesus is really about, where it's just the wow, but we can handle it. Yeah, he's here as our friend, but he knows the truth also, and his teaching and his presence is just wow. But it's not too much. So for me, the Holy Spirit said, okay, look, the culture is really has subverted Jesus so badly in terms of how you feel. We're going to bring in Longchenpa here. Long who? Yeah, but his teaching and the experience I've had with him is just like, wow, this is the father of all Buddhas. You know, this is like, you read about how Tibetan Buddhists see Longchenpa, and it's just like, wow. The father of all Buddhas. You know, the quintessence of Buddha mind. You know, it's like, the complete culmination of their whole path is Longchenpa. It's like that. The absolute apex of it all. And that he would just, you know, come to me and say, you know, hi, you know, greet me. It's just like, wow. So it's easy. I just, Longchenpa is in the house. It's just, wow. It just, like you're going to roller coaster. Oh, wow. That is so amazing. It is so amazing that we would have access to a Longchenpa at this point. They have done everything possible to try to knock us out in terms of Jesus. Now, they haven't knocked me out at all, but pragmatically, I can see, okay, I'm going to do a little end run around here, you know. They've really, really, really placed a great premium on this, the ego has, those who are believed that life is uncertain, trying to destabilize reality, trying to make us feel uncertain about reality. So we can pretend like, well, you know, we're certain about uncertainty, so we're greater than reality. So we do these things to keep our momentum going, keep the wow going, etc. Now, there's much that could be said. Apparently, you know, I don't even bother reacting. I don't react to anything that's going on. I don't even watch the news. Doesn't matter. Who cares what form silliness takes, you know, uncertainty takes. They're trying to make us think that life is uncertain. So, oh, people died. So look how uncertain, look how unpredictable, look how uncertain life is. What nonsense. Life is perfectly certain. So who cares what form silliness takes, what form illusion takes? It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. So I don't pay attention. I really don't. People mention to me, I just say, ah. Just in the same old, you know. Who cares? Doesn't matter what form it takes. It's all nonsense. It's all premeditated nonsense. And people can say, "Oh, you don't have a heart," blah blah blah. Well, then you know what? Then Jesus, if they say that, then Jesus doesn't have a heart, because this is exactly how Jesus sees it. No reaction whatsoever. In fact, all of this world is just an excuse, a ball, a mass of excuses for our failure. Our failure to succeed in denying reality, really, saying that reality is definable. Reality is not definable. when we try to define reality, we feel like a failure. And instead of just admitting we can't define reality, we say, no, I can define reality, except this, you know, tragedy got in my way. I can't think right now. I'm so upset about this tragedy or something. And this is just absolute folly, absolute silliness. Okay, we are engaged in just excuse making. Useless excuses, silly, useless excuses. But people think, no, if we just double down on uncertainty, we'll be certain. We'll be certain that we're uncertain, and that's the answer. Okay, this is just the bottom of the barrel of insanity. And usually you have to bottom out and you'd be saying, I don't understand. How come it didn't work? I suppose it should have worked. You know? But we keep turning to the ego for advice, and the ego keeps giving us this insane advice. What else can it do? It's the excuse maker. It says, of course you could succeed, but, you got this problem. And so fix the problem and you'll be fine. Now, I wrote this analogy down of a really great analogy, and it's very profound. And I'm just working on it and seeing, oh, wow, this is really true, is it not? And you may be able to come up with your own analogy, but it's the Tinkerbell analogy. The Tinkerbell problem. Let's say there's this animator at Disney Studios, and they animate Tinkerbell. So Tinkerbell's going around sprinkling fairy dust everywhere. And then the animator has this idea. Says, hey, I just have this kind of silly, whimsical idea. Let me animate Tinkerbell to say something like the following. And Tinkerbell animates Tinkerbell, and Tinkerbell says, hey, I feel like I'm just an animated character, and I'm not really real, and I'm being controlled, and I'm not really making my own decisions, not really living my own life. I want to change that. And then the Disney animator has Tinkerbell say, you know what? I think I know a way to do this. In fact, I'm sure I know the way. I'm going to set up a production studio. And so the animator draws, animates Tinkerbell, setting up a production studio, and says, and I'm going to have an animation studio, and I'm going to animate the animator. I'm going to animate the animator. So the animator, Disney animator, has Tinkerbell, setting up a production studio, and then Tinkerbell's drawing animation of this animator. And then the animator has the Disney animator A that is animating the Tinkerbell, drawing the animator B, has the animator B say, hey, I feel like I'm just an animation. I don't really feel like I'm real. I'm really not controlling my own destiny or life. I got to change this, and I think I know a way. And so then the real animator, Disney animator A, who is animating Tinkerbell, animating the animator, now decides to have the animator animate Tinkerbell. And so the animator now is animating Tinkerbell. Okay? And now the animator says, now I'm in control, finally. And then we have Tinkerbell who's now supposedly is being animated by this animator B. And then Tinkerbell says, what? Hey, I feel like I'm being controlled, like I'm just an animated character. I really wanted my own control, my own destiny. I think I know a way. Okay. And so then now the animator A now has animator B, who is animating Tinkerbell, now has Tinkerbell that animates Tinkerbell, setting up production studio, and now again is animating Disney animator number C. You see, and now Tinkerbell says, I'm finally in control of my destiny. Now I'm finally real. You see, and then we have Disney animator C, who's being animated, saying, I don't really feel real. Like, I feel like an animated character. I really got to control my destiny. I think I know a way. I'm going to set up an animation studio and I'm going to animate Tinkerbell. Okay, so. And then Tinkerbell A, B, Tinkerbell C comes up. And then Tinkerbell says the same thing. And then Disney animator number D comes up. And then Tinkerbell D comes up. And then Disney animator E. And then Tinkerbell E. F, G, H, I, J, K, L, M, N, O, P, Q, R, S, T, U, V, W, X, Y, Z. And ad infinitum, you see. It's an infinite regression. It's an infinite regression. And just say, wow. Now, what if the regression happens billions and trillions and trillions and trillions of times? Is there some point where somehow this all becomes real, that Disney animator, five zillion trillion, Tinkerbell animated, Tinkerbell 5 zillion trillion animated, Disney animated character 5 zillion trillion, and it becomes real? At what point does it come real at some point? Or is it Disney animator A, who is still animating all of this, the trillion, 5 zillion trillion, and so-called sequences? Isn't it all just the same sequence being repeated and labeled as if it were some step that was being taken, some process that is being taken? Isn't it actually absolutely flat, with no validity whatsoever, that any of this animations are independent of Disney animator A? Isn't that the case? But don't we, doesn't our imagination run away with us? Aren't we tempted to let it run away and say, oh, wow. And then when you see this, you can then start applying our lives to this, and the dialogues we have, and say, wait a minute. Isn't this what I'm doing? And so we have, let's say, Disney animated figure, the Disney animator G says, G, I think I'm doing something really stupid here. So let me not animate Tinkerbell. Let me just work on my own life. And so Disney animated character G, the animator G, is now working on its own life, and then it says, I want to be enlightened. I think I'm going to be enlightened. I forget about Tinkerbell. Yeah, I guess, I'm just, I'm something wrong with me. Maybe I'm sort of an animated character and sort of not, but maybe if I really live a good life and do good things and good works, I will become, what I really want to be. I'll be a control of my own destiny, and I'll be enlightened and happy. So, isn't it Disney animator A that is still animating this animated character G, which Tinkerbell G supposedly animated? Isn't still it's just the A doing all this animation, and having the animated character, Disney animator G, say, gee, I want to be enlightened. I think if I do good works, I'm going to get better. And blah, blah, blah. Isn't that still coming from the one animator, the real animator? And we say, like, oh my gosh, wow. And then we start applying our life scripts and everything we do, and we say, hey, wait a minute. This sounds very much like it's just words being put in my mouth, like that this body and this life is just is like an animation, but I'm being told that I'm in charge of it and I'm doing it all. But really, it's the prime animator that's doing it, which is spirit, actually, of this experience. The animator is actually spirit of this silly scheme of trying to produce all these steps. But really, they're not steps at all. It's just going around in circles, isn't it? It's just flat circles. It's just this Disney, this animator said, gee, I think just for fun, I'm going to have Tinkerbell animate me. But isn't it the animator animating both Tinkerbell, and the idea of Tinkerbell animating the animator? Isn't that coming from the animator? It's not coming from Tinkerbell at all, is it? Completely, Tinkerbell's completely non-causative. Totally non-causative. So, now, let's say animated Disney animator, 10 billion, says, gee, the animator has that 10 billion say, gee, wow. I think I'm just like an animation. Okay, so what do I need to do? I need to work back through this process. Okay, I'm going to go to 10 billion, 999 billion, or 9,999,999,999 step. And I'm going to, work back and dispel that notion that Tinkerbell animated me. Oh, but okay, now I'm a little bit more in control. Now I'm going to get get free of Tinkerbell again, you know, one more time. But I got billions to go, and gradually working through dispelling Tinkerbell. You didn't animate me this time, but oh, the time before that, yeah, I'm not sure, you know. And is that the way to go? Is that the right way to go? Or who has this idea? Is it Disney character, animated character 10 billion that has this idea? Or is it spirit that says, gee, I've got to work backwards now and each step by step by step and reacquire my power, you know. I gave all my power away to Tinkerbell. Is that true? We gave all our power away? Or is it just our imagination running away with us? Running away with me? Temptation. The temptations tempted me, you know. My imagination is a temptation. The temptations, Tinkerbell and the temptations, tempted me. To run away with your imagination. Let it go and see what it could do. Does it do anything? Did anything even start? Did Tinkerbell ever actually do any animation at all? Or was it the animator, original animator, that was doing all the animation? It's just display, creative display. There's no actual causality in it at all. So, what do you do? Well, spirit wants to keep all these animated figures moving like they're real, and that they've got some purpose. They're trying to get free. But what we do, spirit just says, let me just be still for a while here. Let's not have this animated character do anything at all for a while. Let me just consider if I need to do anything with any animated character, actually. Is there something I need to do? Does the animator need for some particular type of animation to happen in order to free the animations from some spell that they're under? Some delusional spell of aggrandizement that they think that they have power? Does the animator, the original, a real animator, do they need to have the animation play in any particular way to regain, you know, get free of some spell? And Is anything need to happen at all within the animation, actually? What could that possibly be that actually needs to happen? Does the animator need to draw something and say, oh, okay, now this means that it is an animation, whereas before it wasn't an animation? It wasn't coming from the original animator? There's something needs to be done to make it come from the original animator, or has it always been coming from the original animator? These are questions we need to look at. Jesus says we don't need to do anything. Full stop in the wow says don't do anything. Just rest in the wow. Don't analyze. Don't come up with anything. Don't plan. Don't scheme. Don't organize. Don't try. Don't think. Don't interpret. Don't project. Don't hope. Just wow it. Say, wow. Maybe there's absolutely nothing I need to do to be the causal one. Did I give my causality away to Tinkerbell? Maybe I didn't give any of it away. If I haven't given any of it away, why do I need to do something to get it back? Do the animations have to reach me? They have to go on a pilgrimage to find me? And once they find me, they say, oh, you're the one who animated me. Is that going to then give me my animation, my power back? My causality back? Back? How did it back? Where did I lose it? Do I need my animations to recognize me? You're the one. And they say, oh, I finally regained my power. Regained it? But where did it go? If I regained it, where did it go? The animations had the power? They had the power to give it back to me? What is that? Is that true? So, don't answer the questions, you know. Just ask the question open-minded, honestly. You're just being honest, like, hey, wait, wow. And then just wow it. Don't answer it, wow it. Because obviously the answer is self-evident. It's wow. So when you get into this wow, you just stay there and relax and just, it's very intense though. But relax with the intensity. Accept the intensity. Don't struggle against it. Don't contract against the intensity. Just relax as the intensity. Like this, just relax as the intensity. When we say relax, people think, oh, I need to try and relax. No, no, no. Relax as the intensity. Intensity is there. Don't fight against it. Accept it. It's like someone, it's a situation that you're just accepting. You're just accepting it. Okay. So I'm not fighting against it or anything. Not trying to get rid of it. Not trying to make it more. Not trying to make it less. It just is what it is. And I'll just appreciate it. It's the sign of a great, great amount of effort on our part, of willingness, honesty, great deal of honesty on our part. So enjoy the intensity of as honesty emerges like this and shows us, wow. So there's nothing causative in this dream at all, is there? In this, all these animations, nothing causative. It's just the one animator that's doing it. So everything's just an excuse. Say that this causative is just an excuse. Death is just an excuse. It's all it is. It's all in the mind, completely. The mind is just making up these excuses. This whole world, all these bodies are just excuses. That's all they are. This isn't life. This is an excuse to deny life. To keep trying to deny life. It's like having an animated character. Have that animated character bestowing life back on the animator. You know, that's absurd, isn't it? And the animated characters, I don't know how to accept it. I don't know how to accept it. There's some barrier. I can't seem to accept it. There never was any life. We never lost our life. We don't need life to be bestowed upon us. There's no bestowal of life upon us. Give it up. Give up all these animated characters seem to be offering us. They seem to be offering us love and peace and happiness and life and everything. This is the trick. This is the trap. They have nothing to bestow upon us at all. Bodies have nothing to bestow upon us. They're just excuses. So we can say, well, I could have bestowed it upon me, but the body, you know, got in the way or failed or something. There's no bestowal at all. Nothing ever reaches us. No bestowal, no life ever reaches us. We are life. Life doesn't reach us. Life isn't given to us, not bestowed upon us, not returned to us. We are life. Life never leaves itself. It's completely unreachable, unattainable, untouchable, unleavable, right? It never it can never leave itself. So how can it be returned? Some animated, imaginative dream figure is returning life to us? This is, you know, just wow this. You know, don't even label it. Wow is how we get free of labels. When we try to label, we get into trouble. We cannot be we think that some label is being returned to us. Life, the label life has been returned to us, and we're waiting for it to be bestowed upon us so we can finally be alive. We've been missing something. We've been missing that label life. And as soon as we get the label life, then we say, oh, I'm finally complete because now I'm definable. So we're really trying to say that we're definable, determinate, whereas God created us without any definition, completely indeterminate, meaning we're absolutely free. That's the probiotic. Kavita coconut water, very nice. We're absolutely undefinable, absolutely free to experience anything and everything we want every moment. So how can we define that? How can we place a meaningful label on that? For the sake of conversation here and familiarity, we will, you know, say, we will talk and use words, but of course there can't be any label placed upon it. So full stop in the wow is you're just abiding without labels. Get used to abiding without applying any labels. Keep in mind that you can feel suboptimal for a while. When you really make progress, you'll feel suboptimal for a little while. Just like I did on Saturday, I really made a great breakthrough, and it was very, very, very taxing for my nerves. And I felt I just felt so suboptimal. But I said, that's fine. So I'll feel better tomorrow or the next day. And I didn't lose faith. I just said, I know this is what's going on. And lo and behold, this is exactly what happened. Everyone else would have said, I have the flu, I have a cold, I'm coming down with something, this is terrible, and they panicked, and deep down they'd say, oh, okay, I need this excuse, I need it. For me, I said, I don't need this excuse, okay? I know I'll be fine in a little while. And by the way, thank you everyone for positive responses to the video, Reality is Unreachable, and we are that unreachable reality, because really, when you say something like that, the concern is that you'll be blackballed in this world. But that didn't happen in terms of those who view the videos, these videos. So that's tremendous progress for all of us, actually. Tremendous. It shows a tremendous maturity on our part. And so when I realized that, you know, the world didn't end, I wasn't, you know, put on a cross and all this stuff, I started relaxing, so I think everything's going to be fine. But really, every video I make is like this in that I think, you know, wow, maybe this time it's too much. It's too much. I said too much. So it's very difficult. And I get, you know, the backlash. I know the backlash, the concern is going to come. I'm just trying to tweak this, but it doesn't want to tweak. The concern is going to come for me. And fortunately, it turns out to be not as bad as I thought. Not bad at all. Okay. I don't know if that's probably the same old. It's dark outside now. 9 o'clock at this point. So don't just wow it instead of trying to look at the ramifications. It's all flat. We're just going around circles. There's no causation. Nothing has to be bestowed upon us. There's no bestowal. There's no bestowal at all upon us. Never. How could there be? What could deprive life of life? Nothing. That's ridiculous. It's just one life. That's all there is. That cannot be deprived in any way. So this dream of, we think that, well, let's make it positive and bestow, you know, we're going to bestow. This is ridiculous. So don't wait, it's wasting time. Don't wait for any bestowal. It's like time is going to bestow something on now. You know, what? That's utterly ridiculous. What can time bestow upon now? We're waiting for now to get a bestowal from time, actually. and you may feel disoriented in terms of labels, that's good. That's good. Just accept it. Say, thank you. This is great. Right now, I don't know what to say, what labels to attach. That's wonderful. Get comfortable with that. But that's not insanity at all, because again, there's no labels to bestow upon the self. Is now waiting for a label now in order to be what it is? A definition of now? Or we're counting on time to define now? Does time ever come up with a definition of now? A freedom, absolute freedom? So what are we waiting for? Do we need a label? So, and this, wow, you could, I'm feeling like right now, no labels. And I can still speak, but I feel, I call it disorientation, but really it's a reorientation towards freedom. And it's a gentle situation. It's not like we're, you know, doing all sorts of crazy dancing and drugs and trying to disorient ourselves. No. This is a very soft, gentle type of experience. I'm just abiding without labels. Or at least there's an uncertainty about labels right now, as far as don't try to find a label. Don't try to find a label. For the sake of, we don't even label it as wow, but for the sake of speaking, we can just say, yeah, this is wow, just wow. And then let that label go too. Get comfortable without any labels at all. So I don't really know what to label anything at this point. We'll have these experiences when you're willing to do this. You'll have these experiences that suddenly there's a little epiphany within you, in your mind. This epiphany, just like, and you just suddenly feel like, wow, I don't know where I am. I don't know how to label this experience I'm having, this sudden mental experience. I don't know how to label it. And just say, great. Let me just abide in it then. So these are little mini abidances that are very, very helpful. This is what you're looking for. This is what, just allow it. So the more we practice full stop in the wild, the more these little experiences, these little epiphanies will arise. And you just say, oh, okay, that's great. Thank you, God. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, grace of God. This is exactly just, and I'm not going to label it. This is the first one, the second one. I'm not going to label it at all. Just let it be unlabeled. I don't know where I am. I don't know who I am. I don't know what I'm doing. In other words, I don't have any label for myself, for this experiencing. It's just beautiful. It just feels spacious in some way. There's just a sense of spaciousness to it. But the spaciousness from no labels, you see. There's no label spaciousness. It just feels like, it reminds us of reality, actually. So this is our practice. Not becoming acute at labeling stuff. The opposite. And again, we go for these little epiphanies. Now, that doesn't mean that we go around saying, not speaking or nothing. No, why should we do that? The epiphanies come because of our willingness to stop for a little while. And, you know, it could be a little while. Give it 5 minutes, give it 10, you know, give it whatever. Don't even label how long it takes, but yeah, just let it be there. We could do that, can't we? We don't have to watch a basketball game, can we not give a... So instead of watching the end of a basketball game, I had this epiphany, you see? So what is better for us? What is, you know, what is leads us, gets us free of suffering? The epiphanies do. So I don't know what I am at all. I don't know who I am, what I am. I don't know anything about me. I don't have any label to affix. I don't even have the question, where? What do you mean, what do you mean by where? I don't even have the questions of where I am or what I'm doing or anything like that. And yet, I am aware of experiencing that we would, you know, we don't label it, but I'm aware of experiencing this label freeness that seems like it's the term, you know, it's spaciousness, pure presence is just a label. But you might say that this is sort of referring, pointing to the gist of it. Yeah. Some call it peace. You can call it peace, but that's a label. They're all labels, and don't get worried about the labels at all. It's just it's free of labels. There's no labels to affix to it. We don't need them. It's still there. You know, just the idea that, oh, if I don't affix a label, it's going to disappear. It's a mirage. If I label the mirage, it will stay. No, it's just the opposite. If we label it, then we are inviting mirage. Whereas if we don't label it, we're inviting reality. Don't define it. Because it's the presence of freedom itself, which is everything. It's a feeling of sovereignty, absolute sovereignty, with nothing opposing it at all. So what is that? Does it have a center to it? Center is everywhere. But there's no need to label anything. So, when you have this experience, you just know it. You say, oh, okay. Very simple. And we can just say, well, you can use a negative thing. I don't know who I am or what I am, and I don't have any questions, even questioning, to ask who am I or where am I or what am I. The questions don't even arise. There's no need for them. There's no need. There's just the one life. And it's little epiphanies. It's very subtle. It's very subtle. But you can catch the subtlety. It's easy to miss it, though, if you're too caught up in too caffeinated in terms of wanting to explain something. You can miss it, and you can just kind of ride roughshod over it. But if you're willing just to be without labels, without words, labels, anything at all, then it can just arise in you, just like, huh. Nothing to say about it. Nothing to communicate about it. Nothing to say. Nothing to label. No labels to pass on. So here, we experience that. We allow ourselves to experience it. So we don't need to explain it, really, because if we want to experience it, we will. And if we don't want to experience it, no amount of explanation is going to help us. We'll just get more labels. We'll be stuck with, you know, an ocean of labels, thinking that somehow we're bestowing something. We need to return the labels or do something with them. That's just the belief that the animated characters have to do something to liberate, to make themselves just animated characters. That they're holding some power. They're not, animated characters aren't holding any power. None. Zero. They never had any power at all. It's the animator that's animating them. You know, in the cartoons, when the cartoon character does something, pow, you know, does the cartoon character have power? No, zero, right? Zero. It's the screen that just, you know, gives flashes of light here and flashes of light here. It's just a play of light on a screen, right? It would say. And there's nothing to represent. There's no way you can represent it at all. There's no definition. It's a feeling that I'm not definable at all. And so this is expressed as experiencing where we can feel that there's display, ornamentation display, but it feels like soft and spacious and gentle, like it's not fixated. It's not saying, it's not like some animation saying, I am here to bestow something upon you. You know, they're not here to bestow anything upon us. They just are, it's all abidance. Everything's just abiding. This is the peace beyond understanding. The flowers are just there. Just rippling in light. These light flowers just rippling. Like reflections in water or something. They're just rippling. And at any moment, the ripples could be something else. Another flower, different kind of flower or something. You know, it's just... And yet the flower is so beautiful and the rippling of it in the water. Like a reflection in water, it's rippling. And then it could be anything else rippling, reflective rippling there. And it all just is fluid, sort of a soft fluidity to it. It doesn't seem, the hardness isn't there. The crystallized hardness is not there. Like we used to seeing matter, you know, it seems so hard and crystallized and edges. It's not there. It's not, none of that's there. People might say, well, that's being soft-minded. People would say, no. It's being super soft-minded. It's being perfectly soft-minded. When they say it's being soft-minded, they're implying uncertainty. But we say, no. It's certainty. It's certainly super soft-minded. Perfectly soft-minded. So perfectly soft-minded. There's not even a label soft-mindedness present at all. Some would say there's a meditator and a meditation, but there's no meditator and no meditation at all. It's just a, you know, an absence of labels, an absence of doership, of doing, of bestowership. Nothing's being bestowed on anyone. Nothing's being reached. There's no reaching, no bestowing, no attaining, no attaining enlightenment, no doing. Nothing like that. It's just being. So these little epiphanies, you can notice, and you say, what was that? It's like little moments. Jesus calls them holy instants. It may be just an instant, just like that, that quick, and then you're back to your labeling and doing, and the animated characters are busy once again figuring out how to be enlightened, how to get free of their animatedness. What can be funnier than an animated character trying to get free of its animatedness? You know, this is absurd, right? We're making this up. This is our imagination. So this super perfect soft-mindedness seemed to just sort of arisen in me right now, and I'm just sort of, you know, just being with it, just being with it. No bestowal, no reaching, no attaining. Is there a personal self? No, I'm not aware of any personal self. That's a label. There's no center to the experiencing. There's nothing. It's not centered on anything. There's no center. It's just 360 degree this way. You know, it's just. Is the body the center of it? No. Not at all. So. Is the person, is some animated character the center of it, experiencing it? No. So is the animated character experiencing this? No. So what is experiencing it? It's just being. It's just experiencing, just being. Experiencing. It's all being experienced. Is there a center to the experiencing? Not really. You don't really view it as a center. There's not an animated figure experiencing this. And yet you were aware it is experiencing. It is beingness. It is creativity. So we could just say pure awareness is aware of this. We are that pure awareness. Does someone need to have this experience? One of our animated characters, does it need to have this experience? No. To what? To do what? To convince it it's an animated character? Or to convince it it's not? Or what? What? What do these, what does our imagination need to experience? To make it imagination? Isn't it already imagination? Isn't it already just non-causal? The figments of our imagination, aren't they already just animations? But all this talk doesn't mean anything unless you experience it yourself. You just, well, allow the experiencing to happen. And it's funny, it arises when you realize it's not needed for anyone. Nobody needs to experience this. What was that? Screensaver or something. Nobody needs to experience. There's nothing needs to experience this. Nothing needs to have this bestowed upon it. So when we give up trying to bestow this experience on something, that's when we experience it. That's when it's experienced. That's when experiencing happens. We're aware of it. Become aware. Awareness is not waiting for awareness to be bestowed upon it. You see? So when awareness stops waiting for awareness to be bestowed upon it, that's when awareness is experiencing. It says, oh, so this is experiencing. I don't need to have something bestowed upon me. There's no need for bestowal. No need for reachability. I don't need to be reached by something. I don't need for dreams to reach me. They're already one with me. Everything's just one with what is. There's no need to reach that oneness. Oneness already is that. So it's allowing these little moments, and you may have, you may have had thousands of them already in your life, but you didn't realize exactly, what is this? You tried to label, what's this, is that? It's just that for a moment, I just feel I didn't need to label anything. That's okay. I don't need nothing needs to be bestowed on anything at all. Actually, no bestowals, no finding, no labeling. Does a tree need to be labeled? Oh, we bestowed a label on the tree. The idea of humans, the animated characters we call humans, we think that they're doing something great, glorious for God. They're bestowing labels on everything. That's like having an animated character going around saying, hey, you were an animation, but now I bestowed a label upon you. You are no longer an animated tree. You're now a real tree because I call you a tree. If I didn't label you a tree, you would just still be an animation. But of course, these animated characters saying this, these words are being put in their mouths entirely. Their actions, everything is being put in by the one doing the animation. It's just silliness. So allow the epiphanies, allow them. Don't cling to them, don't label them, don't categorize them, catalog them, analyze them. Don't analyze, just wow them, just wow it. That's it, just wow it. The more you practice this wowing, the better it goes for you in terms of these epiphanies, label-free experiences, just experiencing. We don't even know. Is this a day? Our experience. Is it a day? Is it a night? There's no label for it. It's free of that. it have a place in space? No. Is it have a place in time? No. Does it have some process taking place? No. Does it have some forms taking place? No. And yet it's creative display, ornamentation, decoration. Is there decoration being experienced? Yes. But it can be subtle too. It can also not, you know, seem like not so much decoration. It's just sometimes the decorations are amazing. Other times it seems to be just soft, muted, without much decoration. Just a quietness, peacefulness. No conflict, no struggle, nothing trying to assert itself as some label, as something, some animated character asserting itself. I am not an animated character. Do we need that? Do we need the animated characters to assert themselves? I am not an animated character. Or do we need to have them assert themselves? I am an animated character. That's what I am. I am an animated character. I want everyone to know. It's very important. I am an animated character. Do we need the animated characters to do any assertions at all, actually? So when we do assertions, is it the animated characters just doing the assertion, or is it spirit? Spirit says, I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I'm not an animated character at all. I don't need animated characters to assert themselves one way or the other. I'm beyond assertion and non-assertion, attainment and non-attainment, realization and non-realization. All that stuff is for animated characters that we stuff words in their mouths to try and make it, them seem significant. So do we need an animated character to say, you know what, folks? I have just had this great realization that I am an animated character. Is that meaningful? Is that meaningful? Does that have some meaning? What's that? Right this minute, this instant, let all animation be exactly as it is right now, and just shift our attention to clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness, of label freeness, label free experiencing. Does it matter what some animated character is saying or doing? Does that have any relevancy? We need them to do something? We need to pay attention to what the animated characters are doing? Is that true? Does it have any, you know, does it have an effect on what we are, truly are at all? Some animated character drawing cartoons on a sheet of paper, and do we have to draw them in a certain way? Otherwise we're affected, somehow we're affected by that? We have to put words in their mouths to, you know, draw a little bubble. And they says, I am not, I realized, I just had this great realization, I am an animated character that's on a sheet of paper. Is that something that has to happen? Or if we say, I have not yet realized I'm an animated character, does that matter to us? Do we say, in 10 minutes I will realize I am an animated character? Are we going to wait for that realization? Do we need to wait for some realization from an animated character on a piece of paper? Flat piece of paper? A doodle that we're making? Is that, we're waiting for their realization that they're just a doodle? We got to wait to 10 minutes? Do we have to wait 10 minutes? Don't answer it. Wow it. Don't answer it. Wow it. So, you know, our practicing here is still, it's the same wild practice, but we're a little more focused here, and it's like my workouts, my physical workouts have changed. It's amazing. You say, I could have always been doing this. What in the world? What? We keep thinking that we got to go to a gym. We got to have this program. I say, wait a minute. Wait a minute. Wait, 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 wait a minute. For instance, one exercise I do is just squats. I squat down all the way on my haunches, you know, and then I'm balancing on the toes of my feet. And then I do little mini raises, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. It's like bouncing up and down, using my knees and legs, not raising back up, but just going up a little bit and down, little bounce for 20, and then go back, stand back up. Wow. Just do that like 5 times. You say, whoa, my legs, are you kidding me? You know what? I do that like when I'm just get out of my vehicle, do it at a gas station, wherever you are. Just do that. It takes, you know, like a couple minutes, and you will just have this incredible burn and workout on your legs and your balance and everything. It's just amazing. I said, I could have been doing this my whole life. What in the world was I thinking that I'm waiting for, you know, I got to do some awesome workout. Where's the machines, you know? Where's the trainer, the machines? I could just do this. And then the one that's really a mind blower is skipping and hopping and jumping and twirling and sidestepping, you know, side hopping and going sideways, going backwards, going sideways and hopping. Instead of jogging, do that. And it's just like, oh my gosh, this is like a million times better than jogging. What? I could have been doing this my whole life. What have I been thinking? It's really astonishing. I could just do like for a minute of skipping, and you can like see how each skip, how far you can jump with each hop or skip. Skipping, and you kind of hop, and you can sail through the air like for, you know, 5, 6 feet or so, whatever. Just long hopping is called, long skipping. Oh my gosh, this just hits your legs, and it's amazing. And I'm thinking, I'm doing these exercises now that are just so easy to do. Easy to do wherever you are. And I'm saying, I could have done this my whole life. And in the whole life, I've been looking for these real difficult exercises. I need to do this, and not doing anything. What an amazing, mind-blowing, just wow, crazy. And there's no trainers. I've ever known trainers come along and say, hey, you could just do this, because they want you to think you need to, you know, it's more difficult, you need the trainer to help train you and do this and that. No, it's just these simple little exercises. Skip along, instead of walking along, skip. And have it, you're skipping, each one try to propel you as far as you can, like that. And this just gives you an awesome, you know, lower body and cardio workout, and balance and everything. And you can just do it anytime, right? I mean, don't we walk a lot? Well, instead of walking, do the skipping, and do long skipping. And then when you're skipping, kind of twist to one side and then twist to the other side. And as you're skipping along, don't make it straight until you can do that thing. Kind of twisting this way, I'm twisting this way, and twist like you're dancing along almost. And also, you can keep your feet flat on the floor, flat on the floor, and involves your feet. And then just do your feet back and forth like this. And this just gets your calves and your ankles, just burns them. You can do it anytime you're just standing. Just work your feet back and forth. And you might move a little bit as you go along. Oh, wow. I said, it's a fantastic workout. But no, we have to sign up for all these, you know, big things, a triathlon. I got to get to all this gear. I got to call this, you know, clothing. I got to do this. No, you don't. Look at kids, how they're skipping along. These kids just skipping along and singing a song and snapping their fingers, just skip along. And again, kind of almost like airborne, like you're floating along as you skip, go through the air like 3 or 4 feet and skip again and through the feet, skip again like that. And you just feel like you're bounding along like just almost effortlessly. Practice that way. Practice your exercise that way. And it will be a revelation to you. It really will. I have this very interesting realization came of mentally. I often imagine myself, I'm pitching baseball to some batter. I grew up playing baseball, and I love throwing baseballs. It was just like, that's what I did when I was young for a long time. I just loved to pitch, throw a baseball. I could throw it so well. It was just so much fun to just throw a baseball. So I wanted to be a pitcher. I really thought I could, you know, I loved the idea of pitching. It's just throwing a baseball is so fun. Then I imagine I'm throwing to a batter. And what does this represent? The batter represents a problem, and the pitcher represents an animated character solving the problem. I got the batter out. You know, I pitched so good, I got the batter out. So my mind often goes to this scenario that I imagine myself on a pitching mound. I'm up there and I'm just throwing. And sometimes I just boom, boom, boom. But other times I'm struggling. I'm trying to think. How do I get the batter out? Okay, I'm going to throw here. Then I'm going to do this. I'm going to do that. I'm always strategizing. How do I get the batter out? I mean, how do I get rid of this problem? How do I get rid of this problem? And then just yesterday, I started going that again. I say, wait a minute. I just don't want to keep doing this. I'm so tired of this. It's really a struggle. Why do I have to struggle? And then I suddenly realized I can dance. I can skip. And I just started like sort of skipping around the mound. And I forgot all about pitching. I said, I don't have to pitch. I can float, skip around. I don't even need to pitch. I forgot all about the batter. I forgot all about pitching. I was just like, what? I say, yeah, I can just float. I can kind of like hop up in the air and just float for a while, then skip up in the air like this and just sort of glide. I can, you know, skip and then just glide, and then skip again and just glide. And again, the whole problem, trying to get rid of the problem, defeat the problem, vanished for me, vanished. I said, this is like amazing. What happened? And this all started from jumping rope. The Holy Spirit got me jumping rope. Says, you got to start jumping rope. Start jumping, the Holy Spirit said. Hopping and jumping. I said, what? Yeah. So I've been jumping rope for now, you know, 8 months or so. And I'm not, you know, not like I can do 1,000 now or anything. No, my legs get tired. I get tired. I get sore. But it's led now to being able to skip and to hop. And it's like, hey, I remember, didn't I used to... And to dash, be able to dash, you know, how kids dash and then they kind of leap up in the air and like suddenly skid and stop. And they almost, the kids are almost like cartoon characters, which is why they like cartoons. They see these cartoon characters and they say, that's kind of like what I, like me. You know, they'll spin around and they'll jump, suddenly jump up in the air, leap just for fun, for fun. They don't label it and say, why'd you do this? It's just because I can. I did it because I can do it. It's fun. I enjoy doing what I can do. And so getting back to that, somehow the idea that you're supposed to defeat some problem that doesn't arise. And you'll see kids playing, they love to break up their motion into creative ways. Ultimately, you know, they try to stylize it and label it into and sort of dance as you get older. You go to the dances and you're dancing, but then you're getting into the special relationship dance thing. But little kids don't do that. They don't dance in that way, really, unless their parents try to train them or something. But mostly, what do kids do? We're in a restaurant and the kids, they're playing and they just dash. Suddenly I want to go over there. You know, and then they ride, they kind of go, whoo, you know, jump up and you know, just like, they just enjoy the moment and the moving in the moment without trying to structure into a dance. I was never good at dancing. I couldn't structure my movement into dancing. I said, there's something wrong. Why can't I dance? I'm about to do this movement. I forget. What do you mean? I don't feel like doing any particular movement. It's just whatever, you know, whatever arises. I don't feel like being... you know, here's the dance floor. This is where you got to dance. This is where you dance. Get that. Say, nah. I just want to move. I don't want to constrain it to some dance. I never liked that. And in fact, the body is such a constraint. We turn our attention beyond the body. Don't imagine the body is experiencing something. The body is dancing some dance. The body is having this epiphany. No, forget about the body. But when you're able to skip and hop and jump and twirl and meander and groove that way, it makes it easier for the mind, I think, to forget about the body. It's very interesting. Maybe that's why Gurdjieff had them do certain exercises. I think he was onto something, actually. He's probably onto a lot, George Gurdjieff. But he had him doing various exercising. The Sufis do twirling and various. They're onto something. They may be onto something, but that too becomes rather stylized or something. But the Holy Spirit wants me to move. Says, do this, skip and hop. And you don't. You could like just keep skipping on one leg for a while. You don't have to skip on one and hop on the other and then skip on the other and skip. You can go skip on one leg. Right. However long you feel it, and then go on the other one, and then back to skipping. So your movement becomes spontaneous and not labeled, like one leg after the other, not robotic. You're sort of shedding this roboticism, which is the whole world's going to roboticism. You don't want to be like that. You don't want to say, "Oh, this is a dance move. Okay, I need to do this." They say, "No. It's just free. It's just free. I'm not labeling it. I'm not trying to put it into a robotic sequence. I'm not putting it into software. I'm not softwaring myself. Everything is always free. Everything is actually an expression of the allness, of the freedomness." And also, when you're skipping, you are motions. You don't keep your arms like this. Skip, or you can do that just for fun, like or you can just keep your arms up like this. It's just like skip, and have your hands up in the air. I'm skipping, or out to the sides. I'm just skipping, or down there, and just let them just hang loose like that. I'm skipping along, or you can like this and like this and like this, and just practice these different things, skipping along, not dancing like I'm dancing, but I'm just floating. I'm just spontaneously moving through space. Like I'm just floating through this, and I'm just like a cloud floating through space, kind of shift. My appearance just kind of changes and shifting, and I'm not trying to define or label anything. I'm just keep doing creative movement like that, and you can just do it just as you go about the day. You feel a little bit, of course, people are like, "What are you doing?" It's like you're supposed to like do it this way, And I notice I'm doing a little bit more of that. Just like rippling, ripple through. Beautiful, you're just a flower rippling. You're not definable, you're not determinate, you're not a robot. You see, this world is extremely into roboticism right now. This is a vision I had on August 18th, 1999. I had this experience where I was taken to this other world, other realm. And everyone in there was like insanely into roboticism. And I was just like, wow, what is this place? And after a while, I felt like I was dying. Like I was losing my spirit. It was horrible. And I had to go away from this experiencing. And I said, that's just hideous. I never want to be like that in such a realm. Well, this realm here is becoming like that realm, which is why it's so wowish, like the times are so insane. You don't want to be like that. You don't want to be in such a realm. And the people in there were these nerds. I saw them, they're obsessed with robotics, and their whole life is wrapped around robotics. And I experienced it. I said, what is wrong with these people? They're so robotic and obsessed and fixated. I don't want to be like that. I felt like a spiritual death almost. It was so terrible. Well, these people now, this mindset is now in this world as these techies, as these nerds, as these robotic people interested in robotics and stuff. Those are the same, that's the same people that they incarnated here on this planet. They're turning this planet into like their home planet is a robotic planet, obsessed with robotics, obsessed with scripting, labeling and scripting and roboticizing and determinism and all of this, junk nonsense. Don't label, don't label, don't fixate, don't fixate. A moment's fixation, a chance fixation can become a lifetime obsession. A life, this is what I've noticed in the world, is people fall into the trap of fixation and they spend their whole life fixated. I realized my life, like sports, I was fixated. And finally I said, it's time to just stop that. Stop it. I'm not fixated anymore. I just walked away from, the Warriors' potential clinching the championship. I just walked away from it. I'm not going to be fixated on anything like that. Jesus said, flow through life. You can flow through life, not valuing any particular, any appearance, specific appearance at all, just enjoying all the creative display as what it is, just like clouds in the sky. Creative display is all it is. The Beach Boys created like sound clouds, like in the parking lot. Woo, 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 woo. Just shifting and changing. It's like a sound cloud. Or just, and just then, just let it be, and don't fix. Let it just ripple and ripple. And say, oh, rip, flowers are rippling, beautiful. Okay. But we have that within us. This sound clouds and beauty and decoration clouds of all beautiful clouds. Just an endless, 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 endless beauty array, stream of clouds, and just. Let all this just ripple and flow. He says, flow through life. I say, ripple and flow through life, or through excuses. This is not life. It's excuses to try to destabilize life, to remain, to fail to destabilize life. So we don't admit that we're failing to destabilize life. We say, no, I could have succeeded except this excuse. Yeah, I ran into some problems. Otherwise, I would have succeeded. And so, as long as we want to destabilize life, we'll have to make excuses of why we're failing. Why we fail, other than to admit we can't. So all we have to do is just admit we can't do it. So where's the no more attempts? So that no failure. I mean, if you can't do something, how can you fail to do it? That's ridiculous, right? So all we need to do is just a bit. We can't destabilize life. It's impossible. Life cannot even be stabilized. So how can we destabilize it? It's completely indeterminate and unreachable and undefinable. There's nothing to define. How can we say it's stable or unstable? It's beyond stable, stability and instability completely. We can say it's completely unstable. So how can we destabilize it? It's even beyond instability, right? It's just there's nothing there to destabilize. There's no stability to destabilize, and there's no we can't stabilize it because it's indeterminate also. So here we are trying to stabilize or destabilize reality, and it's just we're failing. We say we fail, and we make excuses for our failure. We just make excuses. This body's an excuse we've made. This world's an excuse we've made. Nature's an excuse we've made. These are just excuses. Our experiencing here are excuses. Our wellness is an excuse. So I feel so well, I don't want to focus on that. Our sickness is an excuse. Anything we're feeling as a body is an excuse. Jesus says, in when you're functioning in the right way, the way God created you, the body, you won't feel anything of the body actually. You won't even be aware of the body having any feeling. It's not numb, because that's a feeling too. So it's not numbness. It's not deadness. Deadness is a feeling too. It's just this neutralness, like spaciousness. Like it's not even, there's no body at all, as far as what does a body feel or nothing. No. There's no excuse. You don't need any excuse. So it's just, there's no excuses arising. It's not like there's excuses arising and you're dissipating the excuses. No, there's just no excuses arising at all. So Jesus says the body's just neutral. It's like neutral. Doesn't get in the way. We're not aware of it being in the way or not being in the way. No, the graphics, the art I do is getting better. I keep knocking myself out and better and better. But I reach a point where I realize I could make it even better, but I can't quite do it. Because first I have to put this out and see people get used to it. People get used to it until you say, oh, okay. You know, it's just display. We're used to that now. And then I can, well, I don't want to get ahead of myself. But that seems to be how it is. It just happens when you're ready for it. I just do it. When I'm ready to do it, I just do it. Say, okay, I can do this now. It's just, wow. I say, good thing I didn't do that before. I don't think I could have handled that. It's too beautiful. I would have gotten fixated on it, you know, obsessed with it or fixated on it. Now, ultimately, it helps out in several different ways. It gives us at least like a faint echo, maybe, of this beautiful label freeness. And at the same hand, it helps us recognize that all this expression of decoration in terms of sense, viewing it through sensory perceptions, that's not it. So, you know, all this beautiful spiritualization, all that artwork and stuff, that's not it. That's not it. So we kind of say, "Oh yeah, I've been there, done that," and I'm going beyond that, and so we're not waiting for something to be bestowed upon us from the standpoint of some external art, you know, we're not waiting for some external art to be bestowed upon us. Like I'm waiting for that great, you know, song or great this. Don't wait for anything to be bestowed. There's nothing that can be bestowed upon us. There's nothing to bestow upon us. We are it. And so we can say, oh, I don't need to wait for that to be bestowed upon me. You know, I've already viewed it and stuff. I say, okay, that's not it. I know that there's nothing that can be bestowed upon me at all. I can't be reached. This art cannot reach me. Nothing can reach me. I am the unreachable self. I am the one life, the unreachable one life. Try those sort of affirmations and this often can bring up a wow, a really strong wow. When I say I'm the unreachable oneness. Wow. I'm the completely unperceivable oneness. I can never be seen or perceived. I'm completely unreachable, untouchable by perception. And I am the untouchable oneness, the unreachable oneness, the unattainable oneness. I am completely unattainable. I am that perfect unattainableness. These are very powerful affirmations, very powerful indeed, to bring a wow. Get used to it, not intellectually, but just feel the wow. The more you feel the wow, the more it's okay to have no labels at all. If I'm unattainable, what labels do I need? Do I need to judge some sort of effort to attain what I am? No. Why do I need labels to judge then? Judgment requires labels. If I'm unattainable, there's nothing to judge. So there's no labels to apply. If I'm unreachable, what do I need to pay attention to somebody trying to climb a cliff up to find me and label their attempts? What need do I have to label such attempts? I'm unreachable. So just rest in that unreachability-ness. Unreachableness. So these little epiphanies and these wows, this is how you want to go about your day. And you have to come up with your own way of getting to them and recognize them. Don't steamroll through them. Be loose, hang loose, be relaxed, be spontaneous, and always be willing at any moment. Don't be committed to any next movement, really. Is always be willing just to, oh, yeah, there's the epiphany. Okay, now I'm wowed, just like that. This is how I try to be. You know, you go and do this, but I'm always, every moment I'm saying, you know, this, if this moment's an epiphany, I'm going to just go into the wow right away. Not wait for it. So I have to go. I'm going into the store. I got to keep going to the store. I'm going to the store to buy something. No, the wow happens is, okay, this is more important than following through. Right, with some script that I supposedly have to do this right now. No, let the wow be there. And so now the wow is part, is the central part of your experiencing. You can still go into a store and shop, but now it's about the wow and not about the shopping. You see that? Another thing kids do is like they'll be going real fast and they'll stop real quick. Put on the brakes. That's another exercise you can do. All right, going forward, then suddenly going backwards. Going forward, suddenly going backwards. Still going backwards. Go break real fast and going backwards. Break. You can do so braking really quick and going backwards, or just suddenly coming to stop or skidding to a stop. You know, kids love to run and then jump and then just skid, like, you know, jump and then just skid to a stop like that and try to keep their balance. You know, it's just like. And sometimes, oh, I fell down. So you can, like, on a gravel path, you can, like, run and then suddenly just try to stop. Both feet together, or one sometimes one foot in front of the other, and they just like skid like that. You see kids doing that, skidding? Don't they love to skid? Yeah, I just got some, this is my mind saying, wow, I could try that. But no, we're wearing our nice heels and our leather shoes, and you know, We're beyond that. You know, we're purposeful. We know where we're going. You know, we're animated characters. We have something very important to bestow. You know, really important purpose to bestow something upon. You know, but the kids, they don't worry about that. They run, skid. Kids love skateboards because, you know, you can smooth, you know, you never know, you can move this way, and it's just, they're very fluid, flowing like that, skateboarding. I don't know if I'll get a skateboard or not, because you have to know how to fall if you have a skateboard, right? Because you will fall. I don't know how, you know, nimble I am in terms of that. You don't see too many, you know, 60-year-old skateboarders. I don't know if I've seen any rollerbladers or, you know, skateboarders, but skateboard, yeah, I don't know. But maybe I don't have to. I can just have fun skidding and waltzing along. Waltz along. Come on, waltz along. But not as some choreographed thing. Kids don't choreograph it. They might just for a split second or something, but don't turn it into, what we do is we keep trying to script it and choreograph it and turn it into this fixation. It becomes a lifetime fix, and then you've lost it all. That's not what it's about. You might be going along and just waltz along and then drop it and then just sort of prance along and then tiptoe along. Tiptoe. When was the last time we tiptoed along? Tip-tip-tip-tip, tippy-toes. Tiptoe along. Tiptoe through the tulips. Tiny Tim. Tip. Toes through the tulips. Okay. He was being eccentric, but that was the hippie era, and we tiptoed. Hippie era was like saying, hey, we don't want to leave childhood, really. This whole corporate thing is a scam. Corporate society is a scam. This is the hippies. I mean, and I grew up in that era. I am of that era. And also having your mind blown by the Beach Boys sound clouds. It's just like, whoa. You know, sound clouds. But tiptoe through the tulips. Don't walk through the tulips. Tiptoe through the tulips. Up on your little tippy toes. Like that. And or float through the tulips. You know, moving away that, like, as if you're floating. But you're not, again, choreographing anything. It's just, this is how you're feeling it. You're just feeling it. I'm just feeling this. And at any moment, I can just feel, stop and do something else, or wow it, and just let it go. Let whatever came before, just let it go. You're not saying, wow, I got to write a book, and you know, I got to do this, I got to do that. No, just like a kid. Kid says, hey, there's plenty more of where that came from, right? What do you mean I got all this energy, and I could do whatever. You know, the kid's not saying, I got to robotically choreograph that. This is, no, I feel fluid and free and energetic and, you know, just whatever expression can arise. Just so that the hippies, the whole hip generation, which I was a part of, is that I wasn't quite as desperate about it as the hippies were, because the hippies were the ones who were facing corporate culture. Literally, they're facing the draft in Vietnam, they're facing corporate culture, and they just said, bleh. So they really felt their youth and childhood was going to be snatched away from them, and they really didn't want that to happen. So they started being the trippy hippies, where I was a little bit younger than that, and so I was still kind of a kiddish, and I said, well, you know, I didn't quite feel the desperation they felt. So there was a slight difference there. Because the hippies were like born in the 50s, basically. Like from 1950 through, you know, 50, 55 or something, 54, 50 through 54, 50. Kind of like that, you know, that sort of era. And then, so they were already protesting against corporate culture. Like when I was like 12 in 1968, the hippies were like 20 or something like that, you know, 18, 19. They're kind of getting out of high school and facing the corporate world, or getting out of college. So they were born after the war, the hippies, from, say, 1945 to 55. Kind of that baby boomer, the 10-year thing there. Those were the hippies, really. And so in 68, I would have been 12. So I didn't quite understand, what are they so uptight, what are they so desperate about? They gotta, go to these things and move around and shake, and they're trying to hold on to their youth because the corporate button-down world of that time was really, just like, wow, they stuff you in a cubicle for the rest of your life. People didn't want to do that. Now you got Google, they're trying to keep this youth culture thing going, like, oh yeah, you can kind of sail through, and do that kind of stuff. Which is, the young people now, especially the techies, don't have that kind of fear that the hippies did. And the hippies are driven by a horror of corporate society. And very understandable why they were absolutely horrified and shocked by it. Like, I am simply going to be this robot for the rest of my life, serving the military-industrial complex and corporate culture. And it was like a death. It was like a living death for them. And they just said, wow, this is just hideous. I got to dance, 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 yeah. Woo, 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 woo. Beach Boys, dance, dance, dance. I hit the radio dial and turn it up all the way. I gotta dance right on the spot. This beat's really hot. Yeah, dance on the spot. I mean, the hippies would dance on the spot. Okay, see, it wasn't like you go to discos. Hippies hated discos because it was corporate. It was pulling us back into corporate society where it's very structured. Hippies like to dance on the spot. And the Beach Boys song, Dance, Dance, Dance. When the school bell sounds, I'm done for the day. I hit the radio dial and turn it up all the way. I gotta dance right on the spot. This beat's really hot. Dance, 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 yeah. Ooh, that is a great song. The Beach Boys are just were awesome. And it's just like the hippies danced on the spot. When they heard something, they just said, I gotta dance. And they just started grooving right here, right now, in public. I just gotta dance. Because I don't want to die. It's either dance or die. So here, where do you see that happening? In the button-down tech world we have now, it's got its own button-downness, doesn't it? It really does. They think they're hip. They're not really hip. It's slick hip. It's slick button-downness. It's soft fangness, like the fangs have a dress on them or something, have lipstick on them or something. The snake has lipstick. And the corporate snake has lipstick now. And we think, we're okay. Don't need to be hippies. We don't need to dance on the spot. I love the hippies. I didn't understand them, but I love them. I didn't understand their desperation. I said, why are they doing this? It's kind of like a kid. You said, why? Adults are acting. Why are they? But something in me just said, I love your authenticity and your genuineness. And there's something that kind of got it, like, they want to stay free. They want to stay free. And so that there was some awareness of it, but I didn't feel the same level of desperation. I said, I'm still young. I'm not even thinking about work. I never thought about work, actually. For me, it was just music, free form, just playing whatever you want to play on the spot. For me, it was just, on the spot, I'm just going to play some music on the spot. I don't care where. I carry my guitar with me wherever I went. Where do you see that these days? There used to be a hippie, an old hippie, that would stand outside on a sidewalk and just play guitar all day. Occasionally I see him, but I haven't seen him for a while. He was a homeless person. And he was still saying, I don't want to die. I don't want to die that robotic death. I should have just stopped and listened to him. But these people are so desperate. They don't listen to me. This is what I found. A lot of street preachers and people witnessing to Jesus and stuff. they hear someone's willing to listen to them and they just talk, 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 talk. They don't give me a chance to respond. You know, if they did, you know, they would hear something more, you know, profound. They would hear it very profound, but they don't do that because they're desperate. They're saying, you know, I don't want to be roboticized. And, you know, I would say, hey, full stop in the wild. Start practicing full. Be conscious, more conscious of your desperation. Conscious, there's spiritual practices that will liberate you from this. Stop just letting desperation control you. Be aware of it. Use it as motivation, but be super brilliant about it. You know, super brilliant, and listen to the great teachers instead of just street preaching or something. Yeah, that's not it. That's hippiedom, which is beautiful. They want to just stop on the spot and just witness to someone, you know. That's fine, but there's still a roboticism to it, you know what I'm saying? Because they're not willing to listen to the great teachers. I could tell, look, I said, listen, really hear what they're saying. That's how I spend my time. I really hear what they say. They're not willing to do it. I said, I don't have time for that. Well, that's roboticism. You got to do it right now, on the spot. Dance right on the spot. Beach Boys song, This Car of Mine. Another great song, Dennis Wilson singing lead. He was the least talented of the Wilson brothers, Brian, Carl, and Dennis. And he sang lead on This Car of Mine. It's like a minute and 34 second song. It's really cool. This car of mine. Oh, when I saw her, yeah, she wasn't, she was old and broke down. This car of mine. Yeah. See, but beneath the coat, rust, I knew she was gold. Beneath the coat, I knew she was gold. No clunker, I never want to part with her, you see. This little car means a heck of a lot to me. This car of mine, whoa. And of course, with the other Beach Boys singing, Dennis sounds great. Anyone would sound great. If you had the Beach Boys singing harmony behind you, you know, a frog would sound great. Actually. Croak, ribbit, ribbit, ribbit. Wow, what a ribbit. Oh, just grooving on the ribbit, you know. Wow. I just wanted to go around like singing. Come on, people, let's just sing like the Beach Boys. You know, this is what I wanted to do in society. Just walking down the street. Why aren't people just stopping and right on the spot and just dancing or just singing like, but not robotically, you see. Not like a production. I don't like productions. I don't want to be turned into entertainment and theater. It's expressing your freedom right here, right now. Why isn't that happy? I walk down the street and say, what is the matter with everybody? If some inner city kids get it, you know, but they're still kids, kind of. You know, they just suddenly just, you know, break and just. And they say, what's the matter? Are they on drugs or something? Well, unfortunately, a lot of them are. But people look at you like, oh, somebody's on drugs. Somebody's having bipolar. Having a bipolar episode. So we are robotically corporatized in a horrible way right now, actually. It's maybe it's time to be a hippie. I'm feeling a desperation now. I really see, wow, this whole world is in a desperate situation. This car of mine. When I saw her. I can dial that up. Let's see if I can dial up This Car of Mine. Listen to it. I mean, this advice, you know, it's good advice. I know it's good advice. I feel it. You know, I feel the compassion. I feel it. The Holy Spirit has me do all this stuff that, you know, you think, that's not spiritual. Skipping along, what's spiritual about that? Actually, it's profound. The Holy Spirit's advice is 360 degrees. You're not going in any particular direction. Okay? You're already there. You're already there. You just need to start being aware you can express this already there-ness. Okay? Because this world doesn't allow you to. It mitigates against it. It mitigates against it to an extreme extent. And then we start making excuses why we can't do it. Say, no, I'm not trapped. I can do it. But the pressure's so severe, we think, oh, if I'm sick, then that's why I'm not doing it. No, I'm not doing it. Because I'm preventing myself from doing it. because I think I need to, you know, nobody will hire me, you know, if I do that. I can't hire, imagine hiring somebody, you know, who suddenly just goes into an epiphany. You know, what employee would hire someone like that? I would, but really it should be what employer would not hire somebody like that? Who would you hire that's not like that? I wouldn't hire anybody that's not like that. It's just that we got it completely reversed and upside down and backwards, don't we? Of course that's who you'd hire. Of course you want your employees to have epiphanies. Right? This car of mine lyrics. See, okay, we can do this. Man, what a song. What a cool song. The early Beach Boys. Oh, wow. It's just like, this car of mine. Oh, when I got her now, she wasn't new. Old and broke down, this car of mine. There's been a lot of races we've been through. No slowpoke now, oh, I never want to part with her, you see. This little car means a heck of a lot to me. This car of mine, whoa. I remember the day, oh, when I chose her over all those old broken junkers. Thought I could tell underneath a coat of rust she was gold. No clunker, just couldn't wait to take her home with me and fix her up just as new as she could be. Oh, this car of mine, woo, this car of mine, woo, this car of mine. And it just, then it just goes all this beautiful harmony and stuff. This car of mine, woo. Wow. What a cool little minute and 34 second song. I mean, only the Beach Boys could do a minute 34 second song, and it's just like epiphany, like a musical epiphany. Like, so it's like this. We think our car is a junker, is old and broke down. You know, I remember the day when I chose her over all those old broken junkers. Thought I could tell underneath a coat of rust she was gold, no clunker. Well, you know what? Underneath our coat of rust, we are gold. We are not a clunker. And when you start skipping and hopping and twirling, you realize, hey, wait a minute. I was just rusted. Underneath this rust, I'm gold. I'm golden. I'm really golden. And if you start to move in a golden way, you just start to realize, wow. You know, I'm not old and broke down. Well, I think I am. This car of mine, when I got her, she wasn't new, old and broke down. This car of mine, there's been a lot of races we've been through. No slow poke now. I never want to part with her. You see, this little car means a heck of a lot to me. And so we may feel old and broke down, but beneath that coat of rust, you know, is gold. No junker. I'm not a junker, actually. No clunker. I'm not a clunker. Yeah. But underneath this rust and broke downness and old and stuff is gold. I'm gold. I'm golden. And so if you keep being robotic, you won't feel that. You won't feel that. So God bless all the hippies. Everyone has a hippie within them. You know, let the hippie out, the hipness out. The hipness is right here, right now, isn't it? The hipsters were those who just spontaneously express their here nowness. Okay? That's a hipster. God bless all the hipsters. God, please fill the world with hipsters, you know, real hipsters. Not the mods and the rockers and you know, that kind of structure roboticism, but the real hipsters who just spontaneously express the now. Maybe they just suddenly sing, this car of mine. Maybe you see, you know, someone at a gas station, your old car, and say, hey, this car of mine. Or some old person is shuffling down the star. Just come up to it dancing, you know. With, you know, this car of mine. Oh, when I got her now, she was new. Old and broke down, this car of mine. There's been a lot of races we've been through. No slowpoke now. I would never want to part with her, you see. This little car means a heck of a lot to me. And you know, you wouldn't sing it this, you know, the same way twice. And you might be dancing and moving. Yeah. I remember the day, when I chose her over all those old broken junkers. Thought I could tell underneath the coat of rust she was gold. No clunker. I just couldn't wait to take her home with me and fix her up just as new as she could be. Now I'm whispering because I'm taping outside and it's 10:30 at night and all this stuff, okay? But I can sing this song, believe me. I can belt it. You know, you got to sing. You say your whole body is just in it. Your whole body is singing it. You are the song. You are the singing. You're not singing it. You are the singing. Because it's spontaneous and it's creative and you can go anywhere with it, you know, and then you feel in control. It's funny, as Tiger Woods said, to gain control, give up control. Tiger Woods, the philosopher, using golf as philosophy. This is true. When you give up control, you feel, I can go anywhere with this, then you can. Then you're really a singer. You are the singer. You're a singer. You're not singing a song. You are just, you are the singer. You are the song. So just imagine coming up with someone, you know, in a wheelchair, just and telling them that, you know, beneath this, listen, I know you look like you're broken down, but you're not. You're not. Because I've been there. I mean, by the time I was 18, I was broken down in a chair. I could hardly even get out of the chair. I was so weak, I couldn't even get out of the chair. This is how bummed out I was by the world. You know, the world bummed me out because I couldn't be myself here. And I couldn't. You know, the hippie thing was more the baby boomer. And I just was not, my generation really didn't get with that. They were kind of like, let's just, you know, hang out and take drugs and listen to music. You know, maybe we can escape it that way or something. Well, the hippies kind of did that too, but we weren't. The hippies actually, you know, they were grooving, and they would dance on the spot downtown. They'd be walking down a sidewalk on Market Street, and they'd just, you know, just be grooving and tossing flowers and just, you know, but then they'd stop and they'd walk me normally. I just, you know, I felt the moment, you know, I was inspired, had a non-dual, unlabeled epiphany, you know, I was just flowing. They'd do it, you know, it was like, but they were older, you know, they had some money, they were part of society, they had their own place, they had their own car, some of them, you know, they had a trust fund, some of them, whatever. Whereas me, I'm just this kid, you know, it's like, I don't think I can get away with that. You know, my parents would say, what are you doing? You're crazy, you know. So the hippies had a certain degree of autonomy and feeling of they can handle themselves in life. I didn't have that. So my generation didn't, you know, have that. So we're kind of the silent generation. We're not haven't gone hippie yet. Although I'm kind of going kind of hippie right here on the videos, right? I'm sort of a spiritual hippie, spiritual video hippie. I'm a video hippie. But no, we have to be too respectful. You know, people will label you gone bipolar. We got to lock this person up. Now, Brad Soland goes into assisted living homes and sings and plays music and stuff. I did that too. I went in there, and I would just really let loose in there. And you could do that because you're singing to people who are like basically on, you know, dying, and so you try anything. You know, they're kind of like kid-like, and so you can get away with that. And they enjoy it. They love it. They say, oh, thank you so much. I had a lady who was so crippled and so sick. They say she'll never get out of the wheelchair ever again. She got out of the wheelchair and started dancing when I was playing. And she was like dancing. She said, oh God. She said, thank you so much. Thank you. So she was just like thrilled by it. You know, people were astonished. I wasn't doing it, but miracles were happening when I was singing in assisted living homes, assisted death homes, actually. Miracles were happening. But, you know, I realized that it's just, you know, it's an epiphany for them, but then they're back in their drugs and they're just, you know, I mean, the whole culture needs to be lifted up. In some manner, so, but it just shows you the power, you know, of going hippie, and that we have it within us. We're old and broke down, but we're no clunker really, because beneath the rust we got a coat. We're gold. The rust is just a superficial coating. And in this unlabeledness, now. You know, people do go to these retirement homes like Brad Soland does and sing beautiful music, and the people love it. I've done this, so I know exactly what it's like. I could do it again, sure. But you know what? We're all in a rest home. We're all in assisted death home. Actually, this is not assisted living, assisted death home. The whole world is an assisted death home. So we don't really have to do, we, you know, we can do it to anybody. We're all in this assisted death home. I'm like a musician, a free spirited hippie that comes into assisted death home of this world and says, guess what? You know, beneath this coat of rust, you know, we're golden. We're absolutely golden. And, you know, and to help people have this epiphanies of unlabeledness. Now, you can be on death's door and have the epiphany, okay? You can be really dying of cancer. You know, you're in hospice and you're in assisted death homes. And someone, who knows, someone might come in someday, you know, you just don't even know how it happens. They come in and just say, you know, here's a flower lay. Let me put it on your neck. Huh? Yeah, what's going on? Yeah, I'll sing you a song. This car of mine dancing. Yeah. Oh, when I got her now, she was a new. Old and broke down, yeah, this car of mine. There's been a lot of races we've been through. No slowpoke now. You know, I'd like to have like a group like the Beach Boys and go into assisted dying homes and sing. I could do it. There's no question. I could hold my own if I had like a Brian Wilson to arrange the harmonies. Brian, where are you? You know. Where's the next Brian Wilson? You know, I'll sing in your group. I could easily do it. I could do it. I got the confidence to do it. I got to practice my woo ah. You know, the woo ah. I actually started that today a little bit. I got a Beach Boys CD now. I'm gonna listen to it while I drive. I'm gonna practice my oohs and my ahs and my wahs and ah. You know, it's got to resonate. And it's etheric, it's spatial, there's no label to it. You know, what are they singing? I don't know. There's a label, I can't really label it. It's just this resonance, this sound cloud resonance. It's just beautiful. It's beautiful. Maybe the greatest musician ever, Brian Wilson, actually. Seriously. He's possibly that. Brian Wilson, the greatest musician that's ever been here in the world, because he heard the resonance, the sound resonance, the vibrational resonance. This is what he was genius at. And he would work the voices and everything until he could hear the resonance of it all, how it all just resonated in spaciousness. And that's how he, you know, what he went for. And that's why nobody can sing like the Beach Boys. There's nobody arranging the resonance like Brian Wilson. He could hear it to such an acute extent. They could fine-tune it and tweak it to such an extent. It's just like you listen to those songs they record on magnetic tape, 50 years ago. It's just like, what? It still sounds just like, it's completely boss. I mean, it's just absolutely, the SoundCloud is still there, and it's just like, wow. They call him America's greatest composer. Yeah. I mean, maybe the world's greatest composer, actually. And we say, oh, yeah, Mozart. Blah, blah, blah. No, not really. Not necessarily. I mean, it was too robotic, you know. Beach Boys was less robotic. They didn't do the stack, the block of the harmonies, which, you know, from Bach blocked it out, the top and the bottom, and then in between the triad chords. That was how, you know, vocal harmonies and music was set up. But Brian Wilson didn't do that. He did it from the lead, the line. He let the lines flow and move within it. You know, so he didn't really block out the chords, so to speak. He more allowed the lines to move and then tried to get the resonance from the lines. You know, it's amazing. That's why it's so hard. Say, how are they doing this? He composed in a different way. And people are still like, you know, can't do it. They're stuck in the blocking. Yeah, you get the top, you get the bottom, then you fill in the third and the fifth and stuff. And Brian, you know, he said, what's he doing? He's doing the 13ths and augmented this and diminished this. And, you know, I was like, what? No, those are just lines. Those are lines. I can do lines because I grew up on the Beach Boys, singing with the Beach Boys. So this is how I learned music was, you know, this lifetime was the Beach Boys, was just these fluid lines. They're not structured. You don't have to, you know, it's just, and in church last Sunday, I was singing I was singing lines, I was singing harmony to all the songs, just trying it out. It's a good place to try it out because nobody can hear you sing anyway in church. You might barely be able to hear yourself. And it was pretty cool. I was doing stuff. I don't just sing what the notes they're singing. I really am very creative how I'm singing along in church. It's like practice for me, actually. Public singing practice. So we're all in assisted death facility here, okay? This world is an assisted death facility, okay? Wow, that. This is very, very true. I remember the day, oh, when I chose her over all those old broken junkers. You see, your voice breaks when you're trying to be quiet like this. You can't resonate. You can't resonate. Yeah, I thought I could tell underneath the coat of rust she was gold. No clunker, no clunker. Ooh, ooh, ah, ooh. Yeah, just couldn't wait to take her home with me. Ba-boom, yeah. And fix her up just as new as she could be. Woo, 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 woo. Da 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 da. Why do you have to have anything? You know, just why not woo? Just wow it and woo it and woe it and flow it. Wow it, woo it, woe it, flow it. There you go. There's a nice little mantra for us all. How much cooler would life be if we could all be like this, you know, if everyone was like this all the time, you know, really, I mean, right? Wouldn't we just resonate into indeterminate label freeness? Yes, we would. Yes, we would. So God bless all you hippies, all of you who did this for us, you know, in the 60s. Because we wouldn't be still breathing like we are if you didn't do that, you know that? That's a fact. If you didn't bust out of corporate culture like you did, we wouldn't be here like this. This is a fact. So we owe an enormous debt of gratitude to the hippies, really. As ragged and rough as it was. No, the fact is they did bust out. They did just groove, you know. I'm just feeling the groove right now, and that's it. I'm just here composing a poem to a seashell. What are you doing, hippies? The hippies like standing on the seashore, you know, like this. They're not moving. And he said, what are you doing? And if you went up to him, said, what are you doing? He said, I'm composing a song to the seashell. There's a seashell right there. I'm composing a poem. He said, what's the poem? It's a silent poem. Really? Oh, how's it go? It's no labels to the poem. It's a silent poem. It's just happening right here, right now. Are you on drugs? No, I'm not. And maybe the hippie is standing there silently like this for like a half an hour. And the dogs on the beach, you know, people are walking the dogs past them, and the hippie's not moving. Because they're in the wowness, this epiphany. Do you know how valuable that is, everyone? Do you know how valuable that is to see that, to experience that? I grew up seeing that and experiencing that. You know how valuable that is? May the whole world be full of hippies forevermore. Who does that now? No, it's structure. Let's have a yoga class. Let's go out on the, you know, the beach and all sit there and we'll make a poem to the shells, you know, we're doing our yoga. That's not hippie. That's not spontaneous. The hippies did it spontaneously. That's the reality factor. Hippies would lie in the sand, roll over and just lie there. What do you do? You're dead? No, I'm one with the sand. I'm one with everything. The sand is, I'm one with the sand, which is one with the ocean, which is one, you know, one with the sky, which is one heartbeat, you know, one life, one heartbeat. There's just one, I'm feeling the heartbeat, just the one heartbeat. There's only one heart beating. And everything is beating as that one heartbeat. These are the hippies. Hippies forever. Hippies forever. So I wanted to be, that way my whole life, but the fear was too strong. The fear factor, this world is assisted. Say, hey, what are you doing? This is, you're an assisted death facility. We got rules here. But I can't float like Tilopa. Tilopa realized and he floated, he went up in the air, the height of seven royal palm trees, so it's written. Yeah, so it's written. He just level floated up into the sky. It was just still grinding sesame seeds up in the sky. It's all the same to me, I mean, there's no labels. I'm here. It's all the same. But right? What do you mean floating? I'm just still grinding sesame seeds. It's all the same on the ground and the sky. It's all one heartbeat. That's hippiness right there, huh? Just go up, float in the sky, and grind your sesame seeds up in the sky. And throwing flower petals down from the sky. It said the Tilopa was throwing flower petals down from the sky. He didn't get it from any teacher. He said he got it from Vajrahara, straight from the Dharmakaya body. His recognition, his realization that I'm unrealizable, I'm unrecognizable. All is unrecognizable. All is unrealizable. I am that. I am that. I'm not recognizing that. I am that. He spent the day grinding sesame seeds, mortar and pestle. Supposedly, he spent the night procuring for a prostitute that somehow that he was sent to serve in that way, that somehow that would help wake him up to the horrors of this world or something, right? I mean, wow. He said that he threw a flower down and hit the prostitute in the forehead, and she was instantly enlightened, and she floated up in the sky with him. This may be apocryphal, I don't know. Some say it was Vajrayogini herself, I don't know, but it's this is all very fluid, and it's beautiful to at least speak in this way. Is it not? Can we not be spiritual hippies here? I can't find any of the clothes we used to wear. Well, the white Levi's I got, but the Jan and Dean shirts, I can't find those. That's okay. I got a nice linen, this nice linen shirt, beautiful linen shirt. For years I looked for this shirt, and I didn't know if I'd ever wear it, but I'm wearing it now, and it's just fabulous. White cargo shorts and this white linen shirt. It's a little cool, so I got a long sleeve, black sort of stretchy sort of undershirt underneath it. It's very nice, very good look, and just. But where are the hippies, please? Where are the people going down the street clapping? Now people go with got the earbuds and they got their smartphones and like walking robotically. Look at their smartphone with earbuds on. Where are the hippies? Just said, hey, I can hear music. I can hear music. Carl Wilson singing lead on "I Can Hear Music," another great song by the Beach Boys. The sounds of the city, baby, seem to disappear. Whoa, I can hear music. I can hear music. Whenever I'm with you, baby, whenever you're near, and it's just using the structure of a romantic relationship to really talk about the self. Whenever the unlabeledness is there, I can hear music. That's what Beach Boys are, very spiritual. Their lyrics are actually designed to be spiritual. They just use this romance as a cultural vehicle to actually to bring these very spiritual notions into the world. Brian Wilson was aware of this. Very, very spiritual stuff. Whenever you're with me, kiss me, baby, whenever you're near. That means whenever I have this epiphany, whenever I'm kissed by this epiphany of unlabelness, I can hear music. I really can. What a gorgeous song that is. I'm loving you, it keeps me satisfied, and I can't explain. No, the way I'm feeling inside. You know, da 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 da. Baby, that's why when we're all alone, boom, I can hear music. Drop the person out of it, the body out of all stuff. Drop all that, and it's talking about the self, the unstructured, unlabeled, undefinable, free self, the unreachable self. I can hear music. I can look that up too. I can hear music and I can look it up. How about that? I can hear music, lyrics. Boom, there they are. Bruce Johnson, he's, ah, ooh, this is the way I always dreamed it would be, the way that it is, oh, when you are holding me. I never had a love of my own. Maybe that's why when we're all alone, yeah, it goes boom. I can hear music. I can hear music. Bum, bum, bum. The sounds of the city, baby, seem to, the sound of the city, baby, seems to disappear. Whoa, and I can hear music. Sweet, sweet music. Music. Whenever you touch me, baby, whenever you're near, that means whenever that epiphany, non-dual epiphany comes, whenever you, that feels near, that's when I hear sweet, sweet music. Loving you, it keeps me satisfied, and I can't explain, oh no, the way I'm feeling inside. You look at me, we kiss, and then I close my eyes and here it comes again. Boom, I can hear music. I can hear music. Boom, boom, boom. The sound of the city, baby, seems to disappear. I can hear music, sweet, sweet music, whenever you touch me, baby, yeah, whenever you're near, boom, I hear the sound of the music, baby, 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 I can hear music, goes like that, bum, one of the greatest songs ever written. One of the greatest ever songs ever written, one of the greatest songs ever sung. Man, that song, if you can understand the spiritual, what it's talking about, what it's pointing to, yeah, you're gone. You know, you're really gone. What great stuff. And it got buried, kind of, as the British invasion came here, and the roboticness, structuredness, roboticness, and you know, it just, we lost the spiritual feel of it, but this stuff, this Beach Boys music, if you approach it from the unstructured, indeterminate SoundCloud resonance flowing way that is designed, then you understand it's talking about the self. It's talking about the self. It's not about the girl. It's about the self. But in order to get people to listen to it, the parents to say, oh, it's okay, it's just a little romance song, okay. You know, the Beach Boys is very subversive that way. You know, the kids are listening to this, but if they're with it, they'd realize this is talking about the self. This is talking about the one life. This is talking about epiphanies, the holy instant. It's talking about the holy instant here. Jesus Christ, of course, in miracles, was started dictating October, what was it, 22nd, something like that, 1965. This is, of course, in miracles. Please take notes. Well, the Beach Boys were churning out this great music at that point in time. So this is when it was happening. I don't know what year this came out. I Can Hear Music was a song written by Jeff Berry, Ellie Greenwich, and Phil Spector. It was first recorded by the Ronettes in 1966 and later covered by the Beach Boys. So it was, you know, it was the great writers, Jeff Berry and Ellie Greenwich, who wrote, and Phil Spector, of course, produced it for the Ronettes. So actually, the Beach Boys covered it. Interesting. So they didn't write it. Okay, that's right. But boy, when they sang it, With the Ronettes and Phil Spector, it was more of a romantic song, right? I mean, it sounded like this is what it's about. When the Beach Boys sing it, you could feel the spiritualness, what it's really, what they're getting at is it's the self. Okay. 1969 on their album 2020. Yeah, 1969. So, A Course in Miracles is already being dictated at that time by Jesus Christ to Helen Schuckman. Taking notes, shorthand. I don't know if I've heard the Ronettes do that. So, anyway, the hippiness of it all, right? I mean, can we knock, walk down a street and you just we just feel the softness of the perfect super softness of mind, of unlabeled mind. And it's like sweet, sweet music to us, is it not? Why don't we just break out in song and sing, I Can Hear Music? Why don't we know the song? Why doesn't the cult see, culture needs to have this spiritual music in order to really to reach this the perfect super softness of unlabeled mind. They need to have the shorthand. We need to be able to relate to one another musically in such a way. So why doesn't everybody know I Can Hear Music? Why don't we someone else, you know, someone starts singing I Can Hear Music walking down the sidewalk, and then somebody else picks it up and they join in and they start walking with them, and before you know it, you've got like, you know, 10 people all singing and harmonizing. Why can't we do that? I could do it. Why can't we do that? What is wrong with us? Because we're robotic. I could join in. The Coca-Cola song, I to teach the world to sing in perfect harmony. And all these people like joining in, they're all walking up to the top of a mountain and singing or something like that. This is Coke is stealing the idea of a spiritual culture in order to sell Coca-Cola. Why can't someone just start singing? And other people start joining in, like the Pied Piper, and everybody joins in singing, and they all know the song. Do we have a song like that? What is wrong with our culture? Everything is wrong with it, actually. Now, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu in Bengal did do that. He was like a Pied Piper, but they all knew the spiritual songs, Haribo, Haribo, you know, and the tambourines. And the drums, and he just walked through the roads of Bengal, through the villages, towns, and cities. And when he walked out of that town, you know, half the town was walking with him, singing Kirtan, Sankirtana. He said that's the way to be free in this day and age. Well, the Hare Krishnas, of course, tried to do that, and for a while, but it didn't work. I mean, if you walk through a town right now, Haribo, Haribo, you know, Hey Bhagavan. Hey Bhagavan, hey Bhagavan, hey Bhagavan, hey Bhagavan, hey Bhagavan. You know, everybody, hey Bhagavan. The chorus comes in. Everybody's just singing. It's all okay, and they just walk out of the village, clapping and singing, and they'll go to the next village, the next one, and he had this massive train of people. He entrained all these people going around Bengal and Bihar, singing Sankirtana and being enlightened, you know, going into this unlabeled condition, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Dharma King. This is where the Hare Krishna movement came from. Yeah, where is that right now? Where is that? Good God Almighty, would it be that this would happen here now, you know? I mean, I miss that. Maybe I was part of that. I probably was. Because it's in me, you know, very much so. I want that to happen in this world. I keep expecting it to happen. It's not happening. What's the matter with this world? Where is Sri Chaitanya walking through in a divine kirtana and divine, you know, just absolutely in this divine state of a divine intoxication, walking through our villages and towns? And why can't we just walk out with them and for the next 2 months just be lost in Sankirtana? We should be able to do that. As a matter of fact, the father of Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma in Bengal, that's what he did. would someone wandering balls would come through doing divine singing like this, he would just leave with them and they'd go singing around the countryside. Nobody had any idea where he was. Sometimes he'd be gone for a year and then he'd just show up one day. This is what happened. And nobody's no problem, you know. It's like this is what people did back then. If some divinely intoxicated musicians came through, you would start singing with them and you would go on with them to sing to others, and others would go on with you, and you spread this